Welcome, 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 geeks and nerds, girls and boys, to a brand new episode of Geek to Me Radio. Tonight, we have a brand new show for you with five, count them, five guests. A lot to get into, covering a lot of different topics, all that and more. Stand by. And for those of you driving around the greater St. Louis area tonight, listening to us on the big 550 KTRS, hello to all of you. We appreciate you tuning in. If you're looking for video, no video tonight. While this is a brand new show, I am not in studio. I am out and about and unable to bring you a live show. However, it is a new show. You guys know I don't leave you best of material or something like that. I always bring you brand new interviews and exciting conversations. So that being said, we've got a bunch of conversations to get to, but before we dive into it, I want to remind you about Two Rivers Comic Con. You can go check out the website, the number 2, Rivers Comic Con, and that's the website. It's a .com, of course, and you'll be able to check out our guest announcements. You can check out what we've got going on, where we'll be, all that kind of stuff. It's in historic St. Charles, right along Riverside by the Foundry and the Steel Shop. Great facilities where we'll be housing our voice actors and our comic book artists and writers and local talent as well. It's going to be a great time. Everything's in motion. Everything's in flux. We keep adding new dynamics to the con as we go. But I'm so excited about what we've done. My partner Paul and I have been getting a lot of stuff together. He's been fantastic. He's a numbers guy, which anyone who knows me knows numbers is not my strong suit. So that's helpful to have him. He's been just, you know, we seem to complement each other well. So it's been really good. And we're doing a lot of great stuff, getting a lot of great talent to come in. If you've seen the website, you already know we've got Phil Hester. We've got Andy Parks. We've got Roy Thomas, Stan Lee's heir apparent at Marvel Comics, Keith Williams. And that's just the ones we've announced so far. We're going to keep announcing people as we go. We've already got some people locked in, but we kind of want to trickle these out so we don't just bombard you with a fire hose all at once. So keep checking the website, the number two, riverscomiccon.com for more updates there as we get closer. Tickets are now on sale. Click the tickets tab. You can buy a weekend pass. You can buy individual day tickets. If you just, you know, I can only come on Sunday, that's fine. We'd love to see you on Sunday. Get your Sunday passes. Because of the space, these are going to be limited. So we are going to, at some point, not have enough tickets. It's going to be a limited event. We're not just going to keep selling tickets until the cows come home. And I want to say now, the early bird pricing is up. So that means if you get in now, get your tickets now, the pricing is going to go up. I think we either said in December or January, but check the website. We'll give you that information. We'll give you a countdown to when the ticket prices do go up. But I'd recommend getting in early and getting your tickets early to make sure you can connect with these talents. I didn't mention our voice talent yet. We've got the voice of Wonder Woman, Susan Eisenberg, is coming. We've got voice talent Phil Lamar coming in, who's been in everything. Also the voice of Green Lantern from the Justice League. We have Maria Canals Barrera coming in, the voice of Hawk Girl, and a few other surprises. We've also got Dan Reba and Alan Burnett from Heroic Fine Art, who worked on both those shows. A lot of cool things happening and a lot of cool things that I want you to check out. So make sure you keep checking back at the website, the number two, riverscomiccon.com, and you can get all the details there. Follow us on Twitter at @2RiversComicCon, on Instagram as well, for updates and our guest announcements and things like that there. Our community partners and our sponsors we have coming in, like Two Plumbers Arcade and Brewery, and like the City of St. Charles County Library, who's been a great help. And it's very fun. I'm very excited. But I wanted to give you all that before we get into our segment. So that being said, we might as well start off with a comic book guest, right? Chatting with, for my money, one of the best writers in the business, and I think a lot of people would agree, Mark Waid. Thanks for your time.
I would certainly agree. Thank you very much.
I will talk about the modern stuff right now, Absolute Power. Really cool concept.
Thank you.
A lot of the other writers I've talked to are very excited, and it seems to be tying everything in. I'm an Amanda Waller fan because Jon Ostrander made her such a cool character in Suicide Squad.
Yeah.
Was this an idea that you pitched to DC, or did DC say, we kind of want to do something, and came to you?
That was it. It was DC said, we got Amanda Waller, we really want to do a big payoff on all the stuff we've been doing with her for the last couple of years, and what can you do? And so that was where it came from, and then the rest of us, the rest of the stuff was all put together as we went.
Well, I just had Nicole Maines on the show because she wrote the Dreamer book, and she was so excited to be a part of the lead up to Absolute Power.
Yeah.
And I love the fact that we're seeing people who play these characters now writing Iman Vellani, Ms. Marvel.
Yeah.
Have you had much chance to talk to Nicole at all and see give her your thoughts?
We talked a bunch of times. Yeah, and we collaborated on one of the stories. I mean, she's delightful, and she's really good at what she does. She's way better as a newcomer than she has any right to be. That's for sure.
And with, I want to make sure we talk about your very first story with Superman.
Yeah.
Now you're back writing World's Finest, which is, for my money, the best book DC's putting out right now. I love it.
Thank you.
Was that another concept? Was we wanted a team-up book and they came to you for it? Or did you say, I want to go back and do old-school Superman and Batman?
They actually came to me. They said, we want to do a Batman-Superman book and we want it to be in the classic style because we're not publishing anything at this exact moment that is the classic sort of Bronze Age. Here's what people remember of Superman and Batman growing up. And so that was the edict from editorial, and I was happy to embrace it. It's been a blast. And Dan Mora has such a contemporary line that he makes it look modern, which is terrific.
Did you ask to have him brought on for Absolute Power, or did DC say, you guys are doing well, let's pair him up on Absolute Power as well?
That was more like it. It was just that we're doing such a good job in World's Finest. They said, let's put him on Absolute Power. And then we're going to go on to Justice League Unlimited after that.
You're known for being a comic book historian. You know a lot of your stuff. Was it very easy to reach back and say, okay, these older stories with Clark and Bruce before they knew they were Clark and Bruce and bring in Dick and everything like that? Was it...
It was like falling off a log. It was the easiest thing in the world. It really was. Yeah.
Was there any inclination to bring it a little bit further ahead in time, or was that always the key to, like, no, let's go back to the Dick Grayson Robin?
That's what I really wanted, because I really like Dick Grayson as Robin, and I thought he added something interesting. They've done a bunch of Superman Batman books over the last 20 years, but I think the missing ingredient ended up being Dick Grayson. And you put him in the book as Batman, Robin, and Superman, and it's a whole different dynamic, because Dick can tell the jokes. You know, Dick can be the fun one.
Is it your love for Dick Grayson as Robin that's going to be showcasing in the Batman and Robin, the new series that's coming out that you guys are doing, the year one? Is that mainly because you wanted to highlight Dick Grayson as the Boy Wonder?
It was mostly because Chris Somney wanted to draw that. Okay. That's what he really wanted to do, is Batman and Dick Grayson and Robin. And I said, well, let's build something around that. And so we knocked it around and we're co-plotting it. And it starts in October, November.
Yeah, October is what's slated as right now, but who knows?
Yeah. No, it should be October then, yeah.
And you're running The Flash. I just saw you had the huge omnibus. I'm assuming you sold it because it was beautiful a brick worth of stuff.
Yeah,
but working on that character as long as you did, the run where they think, they all think Barry's come back.
Right.
That was one of my biggest thrills on The Flash run ever. Was that a concept that DC kind of wanted to bring Reverse Flash back, or did you pitch it while you were writing?
We just pitched it while we were writing it. Brian Augustin, who was the editor, and I were, basically... best friends and collaborators on that book, in the sense that we would call each other all the time with ideas, and that sprang out of one of our conversations, and so we wanted to fool everybody and surprise everybody with it. So, no, it just came from our heads.
With the experience you've had, when you go into a project, be it The Flash back then or something like that now, is editorial pretty much back on to let you do your own thing, or is there some heavy-handedness sometimes?
No, there's very rarely heavy-handedness. It's not that I'm a prima donna or anything. I'm happy to take notes. I'm happy to take direction. But after 40 years, they kind of figure that I kind of know what I'm doing at this point. So, by and large, they basically just said, do what you feel like you got to do. And if you're off the beam, we'll step in. But so far, so good.
And I have to talk about your Captain America run, because as that book was ending, before it went into The Heroes Reborn, all the books, Iron Man was so good, having the little Tony Stark come back, and you're running Captain America where you could see things were fading. Were you disappointed that, or did you know that the book was going to change and get relaunched?
Had no idea. Mm-hmm. When we were hired, we had no idea that the decision had already been made to give it over to Rob Liefeld. And, that's Marvel's prerogative. That's fine. But, they were gracious enough to give it back to us when they came back, and I think we made something out of it.
Were you, when you got to pick up with the series again for Volume 3, did you
pick up where you wanted to, or was it kind of you had to kind of adjust things slightly based on the circumstance?
I think the big adjustment was they wanted all the four returning books to have something new about them. And it's easy to do with Iron Man. You give them different armor. It's easy to do with Fantastic Four. You give them new costumes. Avengers, new lineup. But Captain America, we didn't want to change anything. So our concession was, okay, we're going to get rid of his circular shield for a little while, knowing that we will eventually give it back. And that was our one concession to give us something new. But other than that, we were able to kind of do the kind of stories we wanted to do.
Sticking with Marvel, you seem to be able to write ground-level characters like Daredevil and Cap, as well as you do cosmic big ones like the Fantastic Four. As a writer, you must have some bit of a preference as to either I like this genre more or this is easier to write. What would that your wheelhouse be, in your opinion?
I think my wheelhouse is superpowered characters. Is the character, because being able to find ways of showing those powers or showing how they're used that you've never seen before and never thought about before, that's the fun part for me, is figuring out, okay, what is an application of this superpower that you've never seen before?
Yeah. Whether you're just starting on a book or whether you've been on it for a while, what's the most challenging part of writing comic book storylines?
Coming up with new stuff. I mean, there have been, and this is true, there have been more stories told about Batman than about any other character in human history, and that's a fact. And so coming up with a brand new take on Batman, that's really exceptionally hard. Superman, Flash, all those characters. But that, again, is the fun of it.
I want to talk about Gotham by Gaslight, because that was my first Elseworlds tale. It was first Elseworlds, but it launched everything. You worked, again, with Brian on that one.
Yeah.
Now that you see all this Elseworlds stuff out there, you're kind of the grandfather,
and
you kind of started it.
And it feels good. It feels good now. There was a period in about, I don't know, 2005, 2006 or so, when there was so much Elseworlds stuff out there. I remember Brian and I went to a Toys R Us for his kid, and we looked at the action figure aisle, and there were like 20 different Batman Elseworlds figures, a caveman Batman, cowboy Batman, pyre Batman. We looked at it and we're like, oh my God, what have we done? But that's about the point that DC said, we've had a lot of Elseworlds, so let's maybe pull the plug for a little while. But I'm glad to see they relaunched the line. I'm glad to see they're doing more Elseworlds. And I do have a little bit of pride attached to that,
Were you pleased with the movie adaptation of Gaslight?
Yeah, I was. And Brian was, too. I got to talk to him before he passed, and he was very happy with it, too. Yeah.
And you've worked with so many great artists. Obviously, we just talked about Dan Mora, worked with the great Alex Ross on Kingdom Come.
Yeah.
Do you feel like there's always that rapport with certain artists and writers? Do you have, like, if you had to pick three artists who you've had the best working relationship with?
That is hard. I mean, Michael Ringo is at the top of the list.
Yes.
The late Michael Ringo is top of the list. But it's hard to pick three. Dan Mora is certainly on the list. Barry Kitson's on the list. Mm-hmm. Andy Kubert's on the list. Umberto Ramos on the list. It's like asking me to choose my favorite kid. I mean, it's really if there's anybody listening to this and I failed to name you, I apologize. It's late and it's Saturday. It's Sunday of the show and we're all fried. But yes, I've been very lucky that way. Chris Omni,
Oh my God.
Yeah.
Mark Bagley's already assured me he never listens to my show, so you're okay leaving him out.
There you go.
It's
okay.
Fine. And my last thing, with all the stuff you're working on, it seems like busier now than you've ever been. Does it ever get to the point where you just want to step away, take a year or two off, or do you enjoy the writing that much that you don't want to quit?
I enjoy it once I'm about halfway into the script and feel like it's clicking, but if there's that 2 days ahead of time where it's like, oh my God, can I stop the carousel? I just want to get off for a little while. but that's ungrateful, because I'm so lucky to be in this position. Nobody gets to write for 40 years in comics. And I am so happy to be in this position that I can't take it for granted. And I have, like everybody, who has a job, there's the moments where you're like, oh man, this is not a great day. But most days are good.
And my very last question, I know Jerry Ordway was saying he visited the Superman set with a bunch of you, got to see the James Gunn. What are your hopes, what are your outlooks for Superman, without spoiling anything? Or
I have a good feeling. I was the one guy who didn't get to go because I was on a trip to another country at the time, and I saw the photographs, and I mean, I was invited, and I had been going out, and I saw the photographs, and I felt like the kid who has strep throat on snow day, right? I'm looking out the window and watching everybody else having fun, and I'm just on a plane, and I'm so, but I feel, talking to them, I have a really good feeling about it.
And you've got more Comic Cons coming up. We'll make sure website, social media, where's the best place to keep up with you?
MarkWaid.com. I'm also on Instagram as Mark Waid Writer. I'm on Blue Sky. And if you're over 50, I'm on Facebook.
Mark Waid, thanks for your time. I appreciate it.
You bet. Take care.
My thanks to Mark Waid. Very exciting. I look forward to all the stuff he's got coming out as we get further into Absolute Power. Hopefully you've been picking that up. And if you haven't read World's Finest yet, my goodness, do yourself a favor. Go to Bugs Comics and get the back issues. We'll tell you about Bugs Comics on the other side of this break. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio on the Big 550 KTRS. Please stand by.
This is Adrienne Barbeau, a.k.a. Stevie Wayne, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Welcome back to the show, Geek to Me Radio, heard here every Sunday night on the Big 550 KTRS. I'm your host, James Enstall. Want to make sure we tell you about our official comic book store. We just talked to Mark Waid about all the projects he's doing. If any of that sounded remotely interested to you and you haven't gotten in on some of those projects yet, go talk to Larry at Bugs Comics and Games. He will be able to point you in the right direction. He knows the store like the back of his hand. So if you say, hey, I'm looking for World's Finest, you've got all the other issues, but I'm missing issues 3 and 8, he'll go right to this box and dig through. He's like Santa Claus reaching in his magic bag, and he'll pull out, here they are. It's kind of uncanny, his ability to find comic books in his shop. But he's the owner. Of course he knows where everything is. And it is like Christmas. Every Wednesday is new comic book day. And if you're a comic book collector, you know what I'm talking about. You love going in the store on Wednesday, seeing all the new comics. And usually you browse and you pick up a couple back issues as well. But Larry's got a lot of selection. If you want to keep getting your comics, maybe you want to add on some more, but sometimes budgets are a little bit of a constraint, join the Avengers Club. If you tell Larry, hey, I want to sign up for the Avengers Club, you'll start saving money on your new issues, your back issues, toys, games, bag boards, Pokemon cards, whatever it is you're picking up, Funko Pops, whatever it is, you start saving some money, and that way you don't have to feel guilty about enjoying your hobby in this economy. A lot of cool comics coming out. Now, like I said, I highly recommend World's Finest, and that's not just because I interviewed Mark Waid in the last segment. The Incredible Hulk has been really, really good lately. We've gotten some great storylines in that going on. I like the Spider-Man run that Zeb Wells is doing. That's been a lot of fun as well. That storyline's coming to a conclusion. We'll see how it ends here. Daredevil has been fantastic. Those John Romita Jr. covers. But no matter what your tastes are, maybe you're more independent. Maybe you're picking up the new Skybound Transformers. Larry's got it. Go in, say, hey, I'm looking for this. He's got it. If he doesn't have it, he'll order it for you. So that's cool too. He can be your own personal comic concierge. Check him out on Instagram, Bugs Comics and AND Games. And of course, on Facebook, Bugs Comics and Games there. Give his page a like. He'll appreciate that. And we appreciate you checking him out. Brick and mortar store right there on, in O'Fallon, I should say, on Bryan Road. And otherwise, you can check him out online, Facebook and Instagram, Bugs Comics and Games. Very proud to have them as the official comic book sponsor here on Geek to Me Radio. We're going to shift gears now. A little bit of a change up. We're going from comics to music. What? Right now we're talking with two very musically talented people, indeed, Charlton Pettus and Kay Hanley, about a brand new project, Kindergarten the Musical. Thank you both for your time today.
Happy to be here.
So I'm always curious about the genesis of ideas, where this came from, how the two of you merged your talents together on this one. Talk a little bit about how the idea for Kindergarten the Musical came about.
Well, let's see. Going way back in time, there are four of us, Stan Petty, Michelle Lewis, me and Kay. We've all known each other for a long time. We're all East Coast transplants. Several years ago, Michelle and I were supposed to be writing a pithy pop song and got distracted talking about how fun it would be to tell stories in a more TV movie kind of way. We start spitballing titles. One of them was Kindergarten the Musical, and we just kind of stopped and went, oh, that's got some story in it. That's got some story. And a few years later, Kay, Michelle, and Dan were pitching stuff to Disney. That came up. They responded similarly, and here we are.
I think of stuff like this, and I grew up as an 80s kid. I watched Muppet Babies, and it was a lot of musical stuff there. You've got School of Rock. I feel like maybe Kindergarten the Musical could be the perfect trilogy sandwiched in between those two. How does the music for this kind of come about? Because you want it to have, you both are rock and roll people. You've done a lot of music for movies and things like that. How does it translate in the brain when you start writing something for on a children's level that you want this to be have children's sensibilities to it? We'll start with Kay on this one.
So that's actually our magic trick, is that we don't write kid songs. We don't write for kids per se. You know, when we sit down with a script and or when we're imagining a story, it's not hard to remember what it felt like to be five in any given situation, because I still feel the same way that I felt back then. So like to tap into the, I mean, we're really all just like, we're still figuring, I mean, I don't know. I won't speak for you, James, but for myself, and I think for Charlton too, it's, you know, life is just about trying to figure out how to navigate like the social, emotional, all of these feelings that we have, whether we're excited or scared or insecure or looking forward to something. That's what we're writing about. It's very, these like big slices of life, these big emotions, and Birdie, Radish, and Rose are avatars for ourselves, really.
You can totally speak for me, and any tips on figuring it out, I'd greatly take. Any time you can send those my way, that'd be perfect, because I'm still navigating that landscape for sure.
No answers. We only agree with the questions.
That's all we can ask for, then. That's all we can ask for. To your point, this isn't necessarily for children. I think of all the way back to the Warner Brothers cartoons, Bugs Bunny, that had humor in it that just went over adults' heads. Same with Animaniacs in the 90s, and we're seeing it with Bluey now. Bluey is brilliant, and I sit there and watch it. We put it on for my dog when I leave the house, but I end up sitting down to watch these episodes. So I'm assuming this is basically that same level, that the kids are going to like the music and the sounds and the characters and the animation, but the adults are going to stay just because it's so brilliant.
No, it's funny. We're Bluey fans too, like beyond. And I think it's the same idea. Like if you tell true stories, they're interesting to everyone. I mean, you know, if you are part of a family, regardless which part, you're going to recognize yourself and find it compelling.
And I have to ask, just because as I was doing my research on you both, Charlton, I was going through websites and something came up for a book called Exit Strategy. I'm like, oh, that must be a different person. But no, that's you apparently, too.
That is me.
So
slightly different demographic. Demographic, but, you know.
It sounds like you need to stay busy. You've got too much going on. I'm assuming sleep is something you just bypass.
No, I'm a huge fan of sleep. And this is definitely an hour that I'm not intimately familiar with. But no, it's the storytelling thing. You know, we are all storytellers, and we're not sure which way to tell them, but we know we have stories to tell.
And Kay, I've got to give a shout out to you, because obviously Geek to Me Radio, we cover superheroes a lot. We have voice actors on all the time. DC Superhero Girls, Sweet Justice, the theme song to that, I just want to say, absolutely brilliant.
Thank you. Thanks. Yeah, that was a really fun project.
So back to, if we're talking about Kindergarten the Musical, I want to ask, is this a thing which, like, we're going to put it out there and see how it goes, or are there already plans for more than just one season of this?
We have all kinds of plans. I mean, we're planning the ice version, the Kindergarten the Musical, the musical, the Broadway show version. We have massive plans. We just need everyone else to come on board.
The Louis Vuitton fashion line.
Oh yeah, the cat backpack. Yes.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah, I think.
But we're on Disney Junior, and Disney Junior will, you know, there are partners in this, and some decisions will be made by them.
And for casting on this, for the voices that are on here, was that a difficult process? Was it a lengthy search? Sometimes you just, the right person comes in, it's like, that's the person we want for these roles. How did the casting process go?
All three of those questions, the answer is yes. It was lengthy, it was difficult, and when the right person came in, we all knew it immediately.
True. Our cast is absolutely incredible. All eight kids in our classroom are played by kids, and they come into their recording sessions to do their dialogue, their voiceover, in their school uniforms, and they're just like the sweetest kids. They're doing their homework and running their lines. It's such an interesting experience.
You both, as we mentioned, very musically talented, going on tour and everything like that. I've talked to so many people, from actors who do on-camera stuff and then always want to come back and do theater, to musicians like yourself who love touring and love that intimacy with the people. Is that something you both are just, there's no feeling like that, that you just love being on tour and playing live venues?
It's kind of a rush. I mean, you know, going out in front of a lot of people is always this incredible adrenaline hit.
Yeah, I love touring, but I also love I love writing for animation. I love writing music for scripts. I mean, it's, as a creative person, the dream is to just spend your life being creative, and the more ways that I can express that, the happier and more creative I feel.
And I was curious too, because on the IMDb pages, Charlton, you don't have a lot of trivia out there. Kay's got some trivia items. I didn't see anything on yours. So, Charlton, what is something that someone might be surprised to learn about you?
Surprised to learn about me?
Like, you're allergic to chocolate, or your favorite sports team happens to be the Boston Red Sox. Something that people might not know just in knowing you.
Well, I would say all the sports stuff tends to be Boston-centric. So it's Celtics, Patriots, Red Sox. I'm not sure that qualifies as trivia exactly, but...
Okay. But no odd allergies, or like your favorite movie is, 2 Weeks Notice with Sandra Bullock. Something that someone might not know.
Someone told you.
Oh, see? Hopefully, I can edit this out if you want. It's pre-recorded. That's fine.
I'll never admit to it.
I was going to say, I think the fact that Charlton is an author of thrillers is kind of an interesting trivia tidbit.
Yeah, like I said, I had no idea. I'm like, oh, there must be two of them out there. But no, same, doing the author thing as well, which was really cool. That's good. We'll add that into the IMDb trivia page then. Kay saved the day alone. And again, Kindergarten the Musical, if you're just now listening, does premiere. It premiered September 3rd on Disney Junior. Hopefully we can look forward to, like you said, maybe Runefly will put out some backpacks and things. Disney is the marketing king when it comes to this, so we might be able to see that in 2025.
Absolutely.
Disney Junior every day, stream it on Disney Plus whenever you'd like.
And if people want to keep up with the two of you online, find out more about your respective bands and things like that, where's the best place to send them as far as social media and websites? Start with Charlton.
Probably tearsforfears.com.
And Kay?
And I'm an avid tweeter, so you can find me on Twitter at Kay Hanley or letterstocleo.net.
Is that the same as X?
Yeah, it is. Yes, I never know what to do with that. I just kind of say Twitter or X, whichever. It's always difficult for me to pick. But Charlton Pettus, Kay Hanley, I appreciate your time so much. Make sure you check out Kindergarten the Musical. Thank you both for your time. Have a great rest of your day.
Thank you.
My thanks to both those very talented people. Check that out, Kindergarten Musical. You'll be able to stream that, and it seems like it's going to be a lot of fun, especially with those two powerhouses behind it. We're going to take our next commercial break. We'll be right back. You're listening to Geek to Me Radio on the Big 550 KTRS. Please stand by.
They're creepy and they're kooky, mysterious and spooky. They're all together ooky, the Addams Family.
Hello, I'm Sarah Sutton. I play Nyssa in Doctor Who, and you're listening to Geek to Me Radio.
Welcome back to the show, Geek to Me Radio. This segment brought to you by our premier sponsor, the Greater St. Charles Convention and Visitors Bureau. You know them from the website discoverstcharles.com. As you know, I've got a great relationship with the city of St. Charles. I've been helping them out with their festivals for 25 years now. They were the first sponsor to come aboard when I first started this radio show, and I couldn't be more pleased that we're hosting our first ever Comic-Con, Two Rivers Comic-Con, in St. Charles. But not just the con. My gosh, there's constantly things going on down in St. Charles. Don't believe me? head on out there. Boy, this weekend has been beautiful weather. Hopefully you got out and had a chance to enjoy it. Maybe you went out and walked around the Katy Trail. Maybe you got out in Frontier Park and played around. Maybe you went to one of the many parks like Wappelhorst in the greater St. Charles area there. Maybe you went down to the streets of St. Charles and ate outdoors, either at Bar Louie or the Dewey's Pizza or someplace like that. Always a great time in St. Charles, especially along Main Street. Those cobblestone streets, they're just incredibly charming. All those local shops and businesses. And if you just want to get out and find out more, try their Hit the Bricks tour. You can go sign up for those at the Convention and Visitors Bureau right there in the 200 block of South Main, and they'll give you a tour guide and they'll lead you up and down the street. I actually know the tour guides, and they're very, very knowledgeable and they're very good at what they do. It's a lot of fun to go out there and just kind of learn more about it. Maybe you're a resident of St. Charles and you don't really know some of the stuff that, well, you know, I know this is an old building, but what's the significance? You know, you can read the plaques, sure, but you can actually go with a tour guide on their Hit the Bricks tour and actually find out some really cool things. Enjoy the festivals, too. Legends and Lanterns is right around the corner. My gosh, we're almost at the end of September. It seems hard to believe, which means Halloween is biting at our door. Biting at our door? Well, we'll leave it. Halloween's right around the corner, and that means Legends and Lanterns is right around the corner as well. A fantastic time, a spirited journey through Halloween. Check that out. The festival director, Ryan Cooper, puts a lot of great work into that festival, and it shows. We get people coming from all over the country for both Legends and Lanterns and the Sister Festival Christmas Tradition, celebrating its 50th anniversary this year. That's crazy to me, but it's going to be a lot of fun. So whether you're from out of town, whether you're a local, whether you've been there recently or haven't been in a while, check them out. Start your trip at the website, discoverstcharles.com. That's discoverstcharles.com. As we always say, it's an historically good time. Speaking of history, what would history be without the Doctor? And that's the 7th Doctor. We've got an interview with Sylvester McCoy. He's been on the show before. We haven't talked to him in a while, though, and there's a lot to catch up with. Chatting with the great Sylvester McCoy, we were talking a moment ago, and you were saying all the best doctors have been Scottish so far. David, you, Shooty, you still feel that way, right?
Yeah. It was Paul McGann who sent me a message informing me that Shooty was Scottish. I didn't know that. So I wrote back, Scotland 4, Liverpool 2. And, of course, the other, Paul's Liverpudlian. But who do you think is the other Liverpudlian?
Gosh, if I had to guess, I'd say Peter?
No, it's Tom Baker.
Really?
Yeah, and he was born in a working-class part of Liverpool. He must have had a really long, you know, Liverpool accent, you know, like that. And anybody, I mean, now he's this very big, great, wonderful voice.
And talking about the voice, the big Finnish audios that you guys have done have just been incredible. It's great to be able to revisit this character in perpetuity because it doesn't show any signs of slowing down.
No, it's carries on. When I go back, I'm doing a whole month of stories. All of September's reserved for quite a few stories.
With those, I know they're a lot of fun. You can just kind of hang out. But from what I know, talk to Paul about this, they're quite a big production. It's actually, you know, almost other than having sets, it's just like the real thing. Do you enjoy them more as you've gotten to do more of them?
Yes, indeed I do. I mean, I really enjoy it because, well, partly because you don't have to learn the lines. Right. And also, I mean, I'm 6 feet tall on the radio, and, you know, the sets don't shake.
That's true. That's
yeah.
Very true.
So, no, I do enjoy them. It's a different way of acting because it all you focus what you're saying much more than, you know, because on television you can be visual as well.
Right.
So you've got to encapsulate that into your voice. And it's great feeling, too. I like doing it a lot.
Do you prefer the ones with the smaller cast? I'm assuming you all record in an ensemble. Like, if you've got a multi-doctor storyline, if you've got, like, light at the end, you weren't all 10 of you there. It was just a few of you at a time? Or is it big enough to accommodate a bunch of people?
Oh, it's big enough to accommodate. The studio's big enough, yeah.
Really?
Okay. It's a big, yeah. Recently, I did one, I think it was about 6 or 8 episodes. It was a very long one with loads of different people in it. I think it was like my demise in a way, but you know, in timelines it doesn't matter when, but it was a very long one, and it was good. Yeah, good fun.
You got to work with Alex Kingston, who now as River Song has been companion to more doctors. Even she beat out Sarah Jane. How do you like doing the Diary of River Song ones?
Oh, they're great. I mean, she's great fun. I really like her. We got on really well. She's smashing fun. I've hung out with her at conventions and we have a laugh. So she's a friend, you see.
Good.
So it's nice doing with her, yeah.
I haven't seen you play the spoons yet since you've been here. Is it coming at the end of the day?
Well, no, I forgot. I've got the spoons with me in my spoon case, but it's upstairs in the hotel.
Okay.
And it's now packed away because I'm flying out tonight.
Gotcha.
So no spoons this visit.
That's all right. Sense 8, that J. Michael Straczynski did that series, then you were the old man of Hoy.
Yeah.
That seemed like it was such a departure for a lot of stuff you did, and you seemed, on camera anyway, to be enjoying the living daylights out of yourself.
Oh, I loved it. I loved doing it. It was great. I enjoyed so much doing that show. It was very sad, though, partly, because the head writer, he came up to me and said, because I arrived in the second season, they said, we got plans for you in the third season. And then the third season never happened. And that was very sad. But thankfully, the fans insisted that we should finish the story. So we got to film the last, you know, little film. That was lovely. And I enjoyed doing that immensely. Working with Lana Wachowski was great. She was really great.
I've never seen such an outcry from fans wanting that third season as much. That show had a huge following.
I know, but in a way, it was a very expensive. Because they travelled everywhere. There was no green screen. There was no... It was actually... They were there. And, I mean, they flew me to Chicago to do one line.
Really?
You know, but... You know, anyway, I suppose that must have been the finance of it was to... They didn't want to spend too much money on it. I loved it. I loved the show.
Doing the Big Finish audios, you've done a lot of other voice of video games. You were basically recently Nibbles, I believe, a beaver.
Yes.
And so have you just taken to voice acting? Did Big Finish kind of help you ease into it? How was the process for you?
Well, I mean, many years ago, I did lots of voice adverts for, you know, for commercial radio, especially in Scotland. And then, I kind of found it very easy to do Big Finish, partly, yeah. It's like one of these things. I never trained for anything, but people keep asking me to do something. I did it, and it seems it worked. I've been in an opera. I've done musicals. I had a musical written for me. In fact, the reason why I got Doctor Who was a wonderful poet and playwright, Adrian Mitchell, wrote a musical about the Pied Piper, which we did at the National Theatre. And John Nathan Turner, the producer, came to the National, saw me there, and went back and said, "I've found my new Doctor."
Really?
Yeah.
From an opera, wow.
Yeah, no, that was a musical.
Oh, a musical, okay.
The opera was Benjamin Britten's version of Midsummer Night's Dream, and I played Puck in that.
And I know, obviously, being from the UK, a lot of Shakespeare stuff, but I've talked to some actors who don't like Shakespeare at all. Where do you land on the Shakespeare scale?
Oh, no, I enjoy Shakespeare. I've done most of Shakespeare's clowns and fools. Typecasting, and I've done most of those. But and my favourite role in Shakespeare was playing the fool in King Lear to Ian McKellen, who I ended up working with on the Hobbit films.
It was 2008, I think. Does that sound right?
Sound about there.
Yeah. And I want to ask you, because you were on the Legend of the Traveling TARDIS podcast. My friend Christian runs that.
All right, yeah.
And they Skyped with you from France because it was during the pandemic and you were stuck in another country.
Yeah.
How was that whole experience for you?
Well, it turned out to be really great, really. I lived in this village up in the mountain. And it was surrounded by forest. And you're only allowed to go 1 hour away from, out for 1 hour and 1 kilometer from your front door. But we used to go into the woods. I used to meet friends surreptitiously, and we'd walk around and chat, and you know, it was safe anyway because we were cut off from the rest of, you know, other villages and towns. And Toulouse was the nearest big city, and so you know, it was safe. Oh yes, I'll tell you what happened was in the hotel there. They had a great chef, and so the hotel got together with the mayor of the village. And agreed that anyone over 75 would get a three-course meal every day for €6. And so I never ate so well. And every now and again, we'd throw in a bottle of wine.
Really?
So it wasn't a bad COVID. I had quite a good COVID.
It's always nice here.
Yeah, you can say that.
So good COVID, and you're still doing Big Finish. Is that pretty much what we can look for you in right now? Are there other plots or projects coming out?
Well, I mean, this year... Father Brown, I don't know, has come out in London, in England, in Scotland, in Ireland, Great Britain, I play a guest in one of the episodes in that, Father Brown.
Looking back on your career, and I won't keep you too much longer, there was always roles you try out for and you didn't get. Was there ever a part that's still kind of like, man, that's the one I really wish I would have gotten?
Well, funnily enough, I was up for Bilbo Baggins in Lord of the Rings. And, you know, it took a year. They whittled down. There were half a dozen people they were thinking about. And eventually I got down to the last two. So there was myself and Ian Holm. Sadly, Ian Holm was free. Otherwise, I'd have got it.
But they brought you back for Radagast, so you still get to play in that universe.
Yeah, no, 12, 10 years later, I got Radagast. And Peter said that he'd, you know, written a bigger part for me than the one in that. So I don't know if that was true or not. But anyway, that I wish it would have been nice. 10 years earlier, it would have been good.
Sure.
Yeah.
And my last question, obviously, Seventh Doctor, it's hard to top that. But if you had one or two other parts that really were your favorites that you fondly remember working on or a favorite series you did, what would those other parts be?
Well, I mean, I could still answer the previous question. There's a part I'd love to have played, which is The Hunchback of Notre Dame. Because, hello... And the thing is, he gets top billing and he only says, Quasimodo, the bells! And then, Esmeralda, Esmeralda! That's all you got to say, and you get top billing.
And you can see the face. That's why I'm sorry this is just radio, because if you can see the face, I would cast you right now. That was amazing.
And there's a hump as well.
What hump? Some young Frankenstein.
Now, in fact, I'd only get playing the hump.
Yeah. And other than that, favorite role that you have played, other than we take Doctor Who off the table, that
well,
you really enjoyed?
I mean, the many roles, theatre roles I've played immense, you know, love doing them. I suppose it was the Pied Piper at the National Theatre was a really important one as well. An evening with Sylvester McCoy, the human bomb, was one. That's where I started. That's where I got my name, because I'm not the real McCoy.
And we'll leave it there. Sylvester McCoy, it's always great to see you. If people want to keep up with you on social media, websites, you're active on X still. Is there anything else that people can watch you on?
I don't know. Someone does it for me, okay. And I don't know anything about it. I communicate by pigeons still.
So for those of you with pigeons, you can get in touch with Sylvester McCoy. A great pleasure to see you again. Thank you so much.
Thank you very much. Bye-bye.
My thanks to the good doctor. Always great to talk to a fellow Scotsman on the radio. We're going to take our last commercial break. We're going to come right back with our last guest. You'll know this guy from several big movies lately, including West Side Story and the recent Hunger Games prequel. Josh Rivera joins us right after the break to talk about his new project. Please stand by.
Look out, he's coming through. He's got a job to do while he rescues the girl. James Bond Jr. chases scum around the world.
Hey, this is Adasa, and even though we don't talk about Bruno, we do talk about Geek to Me Radio. No, we don't talk about Bruno.
Welcome back for our final segment of Geek to Me Radio. We're going to wrap this up with my conversation with Josh Rivera regarding his brand new series from the mind of Ryan Murphy, American Sports Story.
Right now we're talking with actor Josh Rivera, brand new series, American Sports Story, from the mind of the great Ryan Murphy, American Sports Story's Aaron Hernandez. Josh, how are you?
I'm very well. Yeah, I'm really excited. The show just aired last night. It's going to be streaming later today on Hulu. It's very exciting. All of my friends and family were giving me a call about it yesterday. It was funny.
I'm sure it's very, I mean, this is, you've in the just a short career you've had, I mean, my gosh, you've worked with Steven Spielberg, Francis Lawrence, now this being produced by Ryan Murphy, and about such a recent story in the sports world. Talk a little bit, if you could, about the casting process.
Yeah, I mean, from what I understand on their side of it, they had been searching for quite a while, and I was auditioning for Hunger Games, and Nina Jacobson, who was a producer on this show, was also a producer on Hunger Games. And I feel like for a lot of people, I just kind of came out of nowhere a little bit. I don't really know how it looks like on their end. I just from where I'm sitting, it was just like, oh man, how lucky. Because yeah, I mean, I hopped onto Hunger Games, and about 2 months into filming Hunger Games, Nina Jacobson pulled me aside and was like, hey, you got to check out this show. You got to listen to this podcast. Ryan Murphy wants to do a show on it. And then they asked me to do a tape. I did the tape, and then I went to do the screen test. And yeah, I mean, it was quite a significant whirlwind as far as what I was used to. But I don't know what else to say other than I feel really lucky and I'm thankful to a lot of people for giving me the chance.
Were you a big sports guy? Did you play football in high school or anything like that? Were you into sports much?
Yeah, I actually loved sports when I was in high school. I did football. I did track. I wrestled for a little bit too. I tried to play basketball. I'm terrible at basketball. I'm not going to lie to you. That was the only one I couldn't really pick up. But I was really into athletics. I sort of shifted away from that once I started to get more involved in theater and the arts. And then we all know how that went, you know. But as far as like the actual franchise, though, it wasn't something that I really particularly followed very closely. I liked the Broncos. I grew up in Colorado. I think the Tim Tebow era actually was when I was, I think, in like middle school. And then Peyton was playing at a certain point, too. I know bits and pieces. I didn't follow the actual like NFL stuff so much. So this was a very, very informative show for me, too. I didn't realize just how popular the story was, just how widespread it was. It was pretty wild talking to my friends about it. Especially my friends who are in like New England. I mean, they were just like losing their minds over it too. And I was like, oh, you know this story too? And they're like, dude, everybody does.
And our own St. Louis grown Norbert Leo Butts plays Bill Belichick. We always like seeing him on the big screen, everything like that. How is it working with the cast? I mean, Patrick Schwarzenegger, Norbert Leo Butts, it's a fantastic cast.
Yeah, I have very positive things to say about the cast. I love Lindsay, working with her as well, Lindsay Mendez, who's just recently in Merrily We Roll Along, and on Broadway. Norbert, who is like a guy that I remember everybody at my college was like really obsessed with him. And it's kind of really wild to have these people who, you know, I grew up really admiring, and now they're kind of my peers. It's really crazy. And it was a lot of fun, and they're such lovely people. And it's really cool to see also, you know, actors that I really respect and how they approach their work and what kind of professionals they are. It's very inspiring. I had a very, very good time, not only because they're really cool people, but also just because it's amazing to just sort of bear witness to that talent.
And as you're learning, I mean, your second project, if I'm not mistaken, right out of the gate, more or less, was working with Steven Spielberg on West Side Story. I can't imagine as an actor, it's almost like being thrown into the deep end of the pool, I would think. How was that experience? How was it working with a master director like him?
Oh, yeah. I mean, you basically called it out. That was a trial by fire, man. That was my first feature film, and I was scared. I was so nervous I was going to make a fool of myself. And I remember getting hired, and I kept asking my agent, like, are they sure? Are they like, what? And, that was a really, really huge learning experience for me. I'm very happy that I got to work with that team first, because I think that they're used to doing stuff like that. You know, they kickstarted a lot of people's careers. I think that's something that Steven really likes to do is just finding new talent. So it was really lovely to be given that chance and to kind of get more acquainted with what it's like to work on film, what it's like to be on a set and kind of learn that etiquette and the way that things flow and some of the shorthand. And something I really appreciated about them, which I kind of carried with me through my career so far, is I had a real curiosity. They would let me come back to watch the playback all the time. Sometimes I would show up on my days off and Steven would let me, you know, just sit in a chair next to him and just ask him questions about what he was doing.
Wow.
And, yeah, it gave me kind of a real sense for like collaborating and just sort of a general sense for what's going on while filming is happening, which I'm really lucky in that way.
And then Hunger Games, Ballad of Songbirds and Snakes. Francis Lawrence is another great director who can do feature films like Constantine, but also does music videos for some of the hottest artists around. How was working on that project overall?
You know, something really funny, because Francis is a really, really good guy. When I first met him, he wanted to go out for drinks, and he's very, very, you know, there's a real equal ground for everybody. He wants everybody to just feel like we're all coworkers and stuff like that. He was very good at setting up a very friendly environment. I had no idea that he had directed like every music video that I have ever liked.
Right.
Like every song, I know he did I Am Legend and like some of the other movies that he did. I had no idea that he was that he directed every music video. And I remember finding that out like three quarters of the way. It's like, you've met every single recording artist that I like. But, he was a great guy to work for. He had such good energy, and he always just, he always wanted to make sure that everybody was feeling good and comfortable. And again, he was a really easy person to collaborate with. He was very receptive to ideas. It's cool. You know, as an actor, it's kind of difficult to at times find the line with you. There's a lot of other people who have to do their jobs, you know, directors and writers, and they have to maintain the integrity of the vision that they have. So it's difficult to always know how much input that you can give as an actor.
Sure.
But something that the Hunger Games set really taught me was it's okay to be collaborative and give your input and, you know, have ideas for your character. In fact, it's really important, which was really cool. And it was cool to experience that with Francis. He was very generous that way.
And I know we're coming up on the end of our time. I wanted to ask, going back to American Sports Story, getting into the mind of someone like Aaron Hernandez, obviously had a very complicated upbringing, a lot of stuff going on with his family, and then to end with a murder and suicide, what was it like getting into the mindset of someone like this?
It was hard. I mean, it was a complicated process. You know, I did a lot of research on the whole thing, and I tried to pay attention to the really, really important building blocks of his history that I think would affect any young man.
Mm-hmm.
And kind of, it's a series of layers that you just have to put on one after the other after the other. In the beginning, he's a young man who's a bit of a sponge, and then towards the end, he turns into something that, you know, none of us really recognize as viewers.
Yeah.
And it's exciting to be able to take everybody on that ride with us. And I hope everybody, you know, takes something away from it.
American Sports Story, Aaron Hernandez. The premiere dropped yesterday, Tuesday, September 17th. You can check it out on FX, and the episodes drop the next day on Hulu. Josh Rivera, it's been fantastic speaking with you. Continued success. I look forward to seeing how this series ends up.
Yeah, thank you.
Thank you. Have a great rest of your day.
You as well.
That's going to do it. Another show in the books. My thanks to all my guests, Mark Waid. Thank you to Charlton Pettus and Kay Hanley. Thank you to Sylvester McCoy. And of course, thank you to Josh Rivera. Thank you to my executive producer, Joey V, who put this whole show together for me and was able to get it to you so that you can all listen to it for your listening pleasure. We are back live next week with video, with a couple of special guests who you will not want to miss. So make sure you set your radio appointment, your appointment radio, whatever it is. Make sure 10 o'clock Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific, every Sunday night, bringing you a brand new live show in the realm of pop culture. Geeks Me Radio, hope you enjoyed the show tonight. And until next week, my friends.
It's not in the way you watch I sound be. It's not in the way you watch the flash. It's not in the way you love Scotty Young Art. It's not in the way. To me.
Thank you, New England. Good night.